A starship engine the size of a walnut?
Hi, welcome to trailer video number 20. Starship engines the size of walnuts. That clip you saw at the very beginning was from Star Trek, the original series, season 2, episode Return to Tomorrow. And the reason why this topic came up about the size of starship engines is because I had a comment on the YouTube channel, and the video was the demonstration of the PDX-2 test set, or the Paradox test set. Basically, and I'm paraphrasing the comments, is how are you going to bring humanity to the stars with tiny microvolt effects generated with flimsy contraptions built from wood and plastic? And I added the word flimsy in there, and I made it sound a little bit more meaner than his tone or her tone was, because I'm sure a lot of other people are probably wondering this same thing, and it's probably important that we should address this. Okay, and you can read the things from the rules of acquisition, but basically the rules of acquisition basically say that the smaller the effect, the more catastrophic the change is to science and humanity. As you can remember, the Galileo example, the tiny planets that didn't fit into the Earth-centric model, everybody ignored them because they were minor, there were only a few items, who cares? But that ended up, reconciling those planets, those Latin word for wanderers, planet, turned our understanding of the universe inside out. Okay, so with this video, there's two objectives. I'm going to show you that, especially in electromagnetic physics, smaller is better. And also I'm going to show you that engineers have lots of techniques to magnify small effects to make them useful. Okay, I'm going to start off by talking about computers. What you're seeing here is a computer room. I don't know if this was for a university or if this was for a government office or whatever. This is just a picture I took from the internet. But you can see this computer room occupies the entire floor, looks like the entire floor of this building. And this computer is massive. This is a computer probably from the 1960s. Okay, and I don't know if this is an IBM, which version is, I couldn't read that little tag up there which says the version number. But if we go back to the first transistorized IBM computer, which was the IBM 1401, which is built in 1959 using transistors for the first time, it is rated for 200,000 additions per second or 25,000 multiplications per second. Okay, now you compare this computer, which fills an entire floor of an office building. Now, one of the things, before I go on to the Raspberry Pi, is one of the reasons why there's so much room between all these boxes, that's there for two reasons. Number one is because this is probably a office building, the floors of each floor of the office building has limited loading, and so you have to distribute the weight out to be within the loading capacity of the floor, number one. And number two, because all this equipment produces a heck of a lot of noise, and because it also produces a heck of a lot of heat, you need to be able to spread it out so the HVA system can adequately pull the heat out of the room and air condition the room. This Raspberry Pi 4 can do 1.2 billion operations per second. Okay, it would take more than 5,000 of these old computers operating in parallel just to get to the point of what a little Raspberry Pi can do today. This is totally amazing. This fits the concept of miniaturization to the size of a walnut. Once what would fill a room. In fact, this Raspberry Pi has probably more computing power than existed on the face of the planet during the Apollo space program. You could probably run the entire world from this computer and still have a processing power and memory capacity left over to do more. That's amazing. Now, remembering the quote about the Starship engines the size of walnuts and remembering how outrageous that kind of sounded in the beginning, think about this. If you go to these engineers from the 1960s and say, school kids are going to buy because this costs about $40 in today's money. That's about $2 in the money in the 1960s. If you tell these engineers that school kids for $2 are going to be buying computers that are more powerful than all the computing assets combined on the Earth. They would probably laugh at you that that's more outrageous than the quote by Scotty, which was made in the 1960s in the original series about this concept of Starship engines the size of walnuts. This is more, would be more outrageous to them than that quote. Because there's no way they could conceive that this computing power could be shrunk down to the size of a walnut, which is, this is probably, if you just take the chips responsible and get rid of all these, so most of this thing here are connectors so that our big monkey paws can actually put things in and out. But the actual stuff that does the computing, I'm sure you could fit that down into the size of a walnut. Okay, we all have all these big connectors so that our monkey paws can actually plug things into it. Okay, so just consider how amazing this is and how this fits that description of shrinking things down to the size of walnuts, that it is not outrageous of a claim as you might thought. Okay, now let me give you a field effect transistor example, heading over to the talking hands display. In the previous example, I showed you how shrinking semiconductors led to a very powerful increase in computing performance. But there was a drawback to that miniaturization. And that drawback came in the terms of using transistors for power handling. Okay, what you see in front of you is a MOSFET transistor. Now, I'm talking about MOSFET transistors from the 1960s, 70s. And MOSFET transistors from the 1960s and 70s weren't really very good. Now, this transistor is actually from the late 80s. This is a 2N6661, because I don't have one. Or if I do have it, I don't know where it is in my junk transistor collection to show you an example of one from the 1960s. I'm sure I have one somewhere. I just don't want to take the time to look for it. But this, assuming this was a transistor from those early days, it would have had very poor characteristics compared to today. And that's why back in that day, the majority of work in semiconductors was being done using bipolar junction transistors. But what happened was, is when they started miniaturizing these to put these into computer chips, okay, in the beginning, the early CMOS couldn't hold a candle to what's called today TTL logic. But as they kept miniaturizing these transistors and making them smaller and smaller, their characteristics became more and more ideal. And that's why we had that computer revolution. The problem is, though, now that their characteristics are ideal, the problem is they're too tiny to really do any power handling. Oh yeah, you can do computing with them because you're not using a lot of power. And then so they wanted to be able to make a transistor for power handling using these tiny little transistors. So what did they do? They took tens of thousands of those little tiny transistors that would have made up a microchip, and they hooked them up all in parallel so that now you can have a MOSFET transistor that can handle incredible amounts of power. And this is the end result. See, this transistor being from the 1960s or so, probably couldn't handle more than half an amp to an amp. And it would require all kinds of cooling to be able to handle that amount of current. This little bugger over here, which is a PSMN0R9-30, can handle 100 amps. Okay? Less than an amp, 100 amps. Very, very big, very, very tiny. And that's how they were able to make the advances. And so in other words, you can magnify. Even though these transistors on here are tiny, 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 there's thousands of them all acting in parallel. So this looks like one big transistor, and it has incredible characteristics as far as transistors go. In fact, MOSFET transistors have replaced pretty much all other transistors. I've been buying MOSFET transistors for my projects and experiments. I don't think I've purchased a bipolar junction probably in the last 10 years. So MOSFET, metal oxide semiconductors are replacing pretty much everything. And it's interesting that the history is the MOSFET idea was the original idea for the transistor, but they couldn't get it to work. There was too many other little problems they had to overcome. And that's why the intermediate one, the bipolar junction, took over until they figured out all the chemistry and the physics to finally get these guys where they thought they could get them. So it's an amazing history of these metal oxide semiconductors. And this one that here is about 5 years old. I'm sure they got ones that are even more amazing than this. Okay, this only has a 0.9 milliohm resistance when it's on. And so you really don't have to do that much cooling as long as you keep your parameters down. So it's going to have very little voltage drop across this. And that's why this is 100 amps. That's not pulsed. That's continuous. Okay, so see how you can take, you by parallelizing things, you can get the scales of things that you need. Okay, so now you can see that the key takeaway here is that as semiconductor architectures became smaller, their characteristics improved. We can also see this in the electromagnetic equations. If you notice, this is new electromagnetism. This is Coulomb. These term 2 and 3 come from F equals Q, V cross B, yada, yada, yada. But they all have, except for new induction, they have an R squared in the denominator. What this R squared means is that if you reduce the distance between two charges, you do reduce the distance by a factor of 1,000. The effect of the force is to become, because it's an inverse square law, a reduction in the distance between two charges actually makes the force 1,000,000 times more powerful. Okay, and that's why miniaturizing electromagnetic things isn't just a scalable thing. It's actually a square scalable. By making this 1,000 times smaller, it becomes 1,000,000 times more powerful. Think about that. And that's why with electromagnetic physics, this don't fret the little small things, because we can scale them up by doing stuff. And I'm going to talk about more about that later. And this is why atoms are so small. Okay? Because if the electromagnetic effects were, if bigger were better in terms of electromagnetic effects, then atoms would be bigger. But because as you get closer to the size of the atoms, that's where the magic happens. That's where the amazing forces become so powerful that I believe it's actually warping space. And that's why we get down to that size. I believe, and I haven't published this before, I haven't talked to anybody else about this before. This is the first time I'm releasing it. That's where the space becomes nonlinear. And that's where the scaling stops. And that's why atoms are stuck at that size. Because in theory, they should actually go to zero size. But I believe because you're getting down so small that the forces are becoming so powerful that space can no longer conduct the forces because they're just too powerful for space to hold. And that's why atoms are limited to the size that they are. They can't go any smaller. That's the theory I'm running by. I don't have equations for things that small yet, but we will get there. Now let's go off and show you a very small scale effect. All right, with this demonstration, I'm going to show you some very small effects that engineers have scaled up and magnified so that they're in common use today. What I have here is a coil of wire and a magnet and a little microampere meter. Now, if I take this magnet and I whoosh it through the thing, you're like, hey, nothing's happening. Well, that's because this effect is so, so tiny, it is barely registerable on this microampere meter. But we engineers know how to scale things up. See, now if I take a coil with thousands of turns instead of a few turns, and there's more than just this, there's lots of other ways. Okay, hook that up. And now we get a, not a significant deflection of the needle, but we get a deflection of the needle nonetheless. Now, that's what the beauty of having models are, because with the model, I could optimize the shape of the coil and optimize how I move the magnet relative to the coil so that I can make a very powerful effect. Okay, but it shows you that by changing the configurations of the experiment, you can take small effects and you can scale them up to make them useful. Okay, this effect I showed you is something that Michael Faraday would have demonstrated to the kings and queens to get more funding for his scientific research. And a politician by the name of William Gladstone questioned what the practical worth of this electricity was. And Mr. Faraday's answer is, why, sir, there is every possibility or probability that one day you will soon be able to tax it. What a classic way of selling something, obviously to get more funding, but that's what he had to do. And we engineers have, in fact, taken that tiny little effect that I showed you of magnets moving relative to wires, and we've scaled it up for high energy power generation. Okay, so we have scaled it up. There's lots of different ways to scale things up to make things, those tiny little effects, useful. So don't fret on the size of the little effects that we're seeing with the paradox experiments. And that's pretty much what I just said. Okay, so where are we right now? Right now we're trying to reconcile the results of the paradox 2 and paradox 3. My Patreon folks understand my concerns and where we're going right now. But right now, the results that we've had with the paradox 2 and 3 have stymied all reasonable attempts to make sense. But I've had a minor breakthrough, a clue suggesting that there may be two separate effects that we have to isolate. And so we have to develop variants of the paradox 2, paradox 2, paradox 3, and paradox 4. So we can, what we call separation of parameters and isolate the different effects. So the path forward, there's a lot of work that needs to be done in the next month or so. Okay, and the end of this video, after this video is released, this video is going to be released as a public to both Patreon and my YouTube audience. Okay, but after this video, I need all the time, and I'm just going to be making Patreon releases until the PDX experiments have been fully reconciled and new electromagnetism V5 is made public. That'll probably occur closer to the end of the year. Okay, but the Patreon members will be kept up to date on progress. So let me give you a little video status with the talking hands of what's currently going on. I'm giving this status out to both Patreon and YouTube so that the YouTubers can see what the Patreon folks are going to be seeing with this statuses as we go forward. Hi, this is the new, going to replace the ring holder for the upcoming experiments where we're going to use the paradox test set to dive deep into the effects that we're seeing. This is going to replace the ring holder, and what we're going to do, what was supposed to happen, but I got to print it again. I was hoping to get this done this weekend, but I messed up the printing, is this copper wire was supposed to fit snugly in the track. Okay, then the copper would have gone around and then through. So what it would have been is a paradox 2 configuration, except for the fact that instead of these things here moving with the magnets, they're going to remain stationary. That's going to give us one of our variation of parameters, we're called, so we can gather more experimental data in order to disambiguate the effects that we're seeing. Because what we're going to do is we have an armature like this to hold the magnets, and this is for the armature, the shaft to go through and to help line it up. And so the magnets are going to spin relative to the wire. And so this has two different wiring configurations, and there'll be three different armature configurations. So this is going to get us to six sets of experimental data. I was hoping to get this done this weekend, but ran into problems. I've got to reprint this. This damn thing takes 4 hours. I think what I'm going to do is put holes in it to cut down the amount of plastic used. And that should reduce the print time. Because what I really wanted to do, I want the little slot to hold the wire snugly. I thought I had the right dimensions, but you can see the wire pops back out. I thought about using adhesive, but that kind of defeats the purpose of being able to wire this two different ways. If I glue the wire in, then I can't pull the wire out to do the other different wiring configuration. So I'd rather just get it right, because then when other people get to use it, I don't have to explain to them how to use adhesive. Just put the damn wire in the track and yada, yada, yada. The other thing that I was trying to do is get a differential amplifier, times 1000 amplifier for the oscilloscope. This is my original prototype. There's a lot of things I learned about, I tried to make a differential amplifier from the very good precision op amps here. But I knew there was going to be a problem in that unless I wire everything 100% perfectly, this is going to have poor common mode. It's not bad. I had to put you can't see it, but there's a pot stuck down in between the little rails there to hold these things in. But other thing I learned is I tried using a BNC for the input. That's not a good idea, because it gives you different path lengths from the shield to the outside. It turns out the shield ends up becoming a receiver for all kinds of noise. Okay, and so I've learned my lesson, so I've purchased a metal case, and we're gonna have proper binding posts for the input, and the scope will be the standard BNC output. This is powered, but I think the version I'm gonna make, the newer version, I'm just gonna use a 9-volt battery to get rid of this stupid tail thing to power it. I wanted to use the power they supply with the scope leads, but that's just too much research to find. Couldn't find anybody that makes those, so you can just buy them and use them. I don't even know anybody that uses those. I know there's a few out there for instrumented probes. So now one of the reasons why I ended up doing this is because I had my search parameters on DigiKey set for 3-volt amplifiers, because I wanted everything that we're doing with this to be used with the little microvolt package. I wanted to be able to use the same amplifier configuration for both. Okay, but that is not going to happen, because what I did when I expanded my search criteria to include amplifiers that are outside the 3-volt range, I found the ideal amplifier for a scope preamplifier. You can't use it for anything less than 8 volts. Okay, that's why I did not see this in my original search for diff instrumentation amplifiers. But if I'm going to apply power to this, then and 9-volt battery will do this perfectly, then this is the right way to go. Because the nice thing about it, this is all in one package. I don't have to play games with trying to balance both sides of the differential amplifier. They've already done that. These things cost about $11 each. It's a lot less money than me spending time trying to build a differential amplifier from an instrumentation amplifier from scratch. Okay, and this has really excellent noise characteristics. So I'm going to use this one for the scope preamplifier. And this has very high bandwidth, 28 megahertz. So once you put a gain of 1,000 in it, you get 18 kilohertz. So that's more than sufficient for anything we're going to do using the oscilloscope. Because with this guy here, we want to actually see as the magnets rotate around, we want high fidelity, real-time updates. Now, the other thing I'm going to have to do with this is the motor driver. I have to build a circuit that every time the magnet's in the same position, it's going to trigger the scope. I think what I'm going to do is just put a simple TTL counter on the stepper motor driver, and every time the stepper steps out 400 pulses, it's going to give me a pulse to synchronize the scope. That way there I can use a technique in the scope for reducing noise further. So there's lots of things we got to get to before we can get these measurements done. A lot of little ash and trash thing. The other thing is for the instrument package, for the RF instrument package, this is where we're going to go. Again, this is a single chip solution for an instrumentation amplifier, and because this does work down to 3 volts, this is what we're going to put on the RF nano configuration when we get back to that. And the beautiful thing about this is I don't have to put any resistors in there. The RF nano can actually go in and program the gain into it, and this has a gain of up to 4096. So this is going to be allow us to see, and it's got nice noise characteristics. And the other thing too, and this will have a 3 kilohertz bandwidth, which should be more than sufficient for what we're going to use the RF nano on. Okay, I've already got these in stock, and I've got pretty much everything in stock. What's on the way is the metal boxes and the proper binding posts to finish up the new version of the scope times 1000 differential amplifier or instrumentation amplifier. So that's, hopefully we'll get that done next weekend. If the parts come in, we'll get this guy reprinted so that the wire will stick in like it's supposed to. Okay, and so I've made tiny little holes so the wires can come back and we can hook them into the differential amplifier. I think that's it for this weekend. Okay, that ends this video. I want to thank my Patreon folks for their patience. We have a lot of new bridge officers and first officers in the Patreon realm. I will be addressing those folks probably in the next couple of weeks to see what they want. Right now, my existing bridge officers and first officers have made it very clear that they're not worried about their tier benefits. They want the progress is their number one thing that they want as far as their tier benefits. Okay, but I want to make sure that the new bridge officers are okay with that. If not, we're going to try to do something for that tier, because you guys are paying a lot of money, and I really respect that. It's really helping out, and I appreciate that. So we'll see what we can do. Now, I have in the past talked about if we can make money on these inventions, how I would try to form a company and issue shares. I have to talk to the bridge officers and first officers about that and what makes sense. That's a possibility for the future going forward. But ultimately, we'll talk to them about that going forward. Right now, this ends the video. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for your patience. Progress is being made. Thank you. Bye-bye.